Hey Liz, come check this out.
Oh wow, you don't see that every day.
Not at all.
A very peculiar looking creature has been handed into the Australian Reptile Park receptionist, Penny.
We should probably get Tim.
I'll get Tim.
Have a look, yeah.
Penny to Tim.
Go ahead.
Pen.
Hey Tim, we have something here for you that you'd probably like to see.
Sounds interesting. What is it?
It's a bit of an odd one. You'll probably have to check it out for yourself. You're gonna freak.
Righto, I'll be down in a minute.
This is something I've never seen before. Tim's definitely going to be excited to see this one.
What have we got?
Hey, I think we've got a blue tongue lizard.
Holy moly. You do have a blue tongue, but it's got two heads. Look at that. Fair to say, in a long time in zoos, we've never seen that, hey?
Never.
This lizard is a real anomaly. I mean, there must be a chance of one in a million in the wild that something like this is born. And for it to have been found alive, well, spectacular.
Do you think he's going to grow?
If he's got two independent brains and he can swallow and his body's all right, then he might live. It's great that someone found him and recognised that he was different and has brought him to us. Things like this in the wild, well, if they're disadvantaged even a little bit, the wild is harsh. And I don't think he would have survived out there.
What are you going to do?
Down to the vet, hey? We need an answer to know that he's not in pain or anything like that, and then we'll look after him. Looking at him, physically, he's okay. But I'm not a vet, and I guess I really need to know what's going on the inside. I'll take him down now. I'll let you know how I go when I get back.
Thanks, Tim.
Pete the vet, he's in for a surprise. I've taken him weird and wonderful things over the years, but never anything with two heads. Good afternoon, guys.
Hello, Tim.
I know I don't have an appointment, but do you have time for a special little friend of mine?
Tim has arrived at the Green Cross Vet Clinic, about 5 minutes from the Australian Reptile Park.
Have you ever seen anything like that?
He's hoping Dr. Peter Nosworthy can provide some more clues about this very unusual two-headed blue-tongued lizard.
I've never seen a lizard like this before, and I'm worried about how it's going to survive. I'm just going to have a look in his mouth for a moment.
One blue tongue.
Everything looks all right in there. All right, mate, let's have a look on the other side. Yeah, okay. Superficially, from what I can see, they both look normal.
Is it possible that both heads work and swallow and...
I'm sure it is, yeah. I mean, I don't see why it couldn't be. I'd like to take an X-ray of its spine to see that it has got, you know, something that runs from the back of one of its heads down to down through until the tail. X-rays. I would then like to pass a tube down both mouths to see which one goes down to the stomach or whether they both do, out of interest, and see which one we should be feeding or can we feed both. Okay.
What do you got? One or two brains?
I think we have only got one brain, Tim.
One brain, two heads.
One brain, yeah. It's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing.
And the rest of the body looks healthy?
Normal.
Normal.
Normal. Wow. Normal from two heads backwards, he's normal.
The X-rays are done and Pete's happy. But what he wants to see now is what actually happens when he puts a tube down the throat. Do both mouths feed through to the stomach? Mouth open.
Mouth open.
Pete puts the tube down one side and it feeds back to the belly. He then goes to the other head and it does the same. Now that means both mouths are intact and working.
Okay.
So that's good.
He can swallow both sides. Both sides will run down into the abdomen.
It's a great result. But before Tim leaves, there's one more thing that needs to be addressed.
What are you going to call him?
How about Janus?
Janus?
Yeah, it was the Roman god of new beginnings. He had two faces.
Janus?
Janus, yeah.
Well, that's lovely. One lizard, one brain with two heads.
New start, Janus.
I love it. I'm going to take him home, try and get him feeding, get him strong, and hopefully he can live a normal life. Well, that's his home, at least for the next little while until he gets established and starts eating and gets bigger and stronger.
Tim is helping Janus, the blue-tongued lizard, to settle into his new home at the Australian Reptile Park.
I don't know if he's ever eaten since he was born, so I'm actually going to try and just force a little bit into him And maybe that'll give him a taste for it, and tomorrow or in the days to come, it'll stimulate him to start feeding by himself. My little mate. I'm just going to gently pry open his mouth, just put a bit in, just get a little bit of food in there. That's it, good boy. He's eating it. He's licking it. That's fantastic, he knows what to do.
Good boy.
Let's try head number two. Same again. That's a good fella.
When I was down at the vets, Pete said he's got a good response in the mouth. He sure does. He's swallowing that food from both heads.
The last thing I'm going to do is actually try a little cricket. Okay, that's it, mouth's open. Cricket's in.
Look at that. He's eating. Beautiful. In the wild, he wouldn't have survived. At least here, we can give him a chance.
That'll be a good little home for you, mate. You got everything you need in there.
It's all right, sweetie.
Some of his new patients, like 3-year-old Harriet, are definitely unusual.
Good girl, Harriet.
The bearded dragon is a much-loved resident of the Kyabram Fauna Park.
Dr. Chris is going to see us soon, buddy.
Her keeper, Hannah, is worried about a mysterious swelling on her back leg.
She's been in hibernation for 5 weeks and she's just recently come out and she has a lump. We're just a little concerned. She's being a good girl. We love her to death and we just want to make sure she's okay.
Hey, how are you going?
Good, thanks. How are you?
I'm after Harriet. Is that you or is that this little one?
The bearded dragon is Harriet.
Okay.
And I'm Hannah.
So, okay, come on through.
Thank you very much.
Hey, little one, look at you.
She's beautiful.
Yeah. So what's the problem with her?
She's got a lump on her leg, just on her right hind leg.
Just here?
Yep.
Okay. And you can see, she can feel it when I touch it. So has this lump got bigger?
Yeah, it was a lot more soft and mushy. Now it's just hardened up.
I think I'll need to take a sample from it to know for sure what it is. But obviously the biggest worry with any lump is something like a tumour or a cancer.
Cancer would be the absolute worst case scenario for Harriet. She's just too beautiful and precious to us. Hey, sweetie, it's all right, sweetie.
Fingers crossed that this is actually not a tumour and it's something we can actually fix. I want to get a sample from that lump.
Yeah.
So I'm gonna have to stick a needle in there. Yeah. It's just important to know what's sitting inside that lump. The two most likely causes of this are either a tumour.
Yeah.
If that's the case, we're probably gonna get tissue, so pink stuff, maybe in a bit of blood.
Okay, all right.
Yeah. If it is an abscess, we should probably get something that looks a bit like cheese.
It's all right, sweetie.
It's not really conclusive. The fluid that's come out is fairly clear.
Yep.
What I might do is actually just put that under the microscope and just see what sort of cells are sitting in there.
It is scary to know that she may have a cancer or a tumour. If anything bad happened to her, like that type of news, it would be terrible.
All right, there's a lot of one type of cell here. There's a whole lot of pus cells in there. So what we have is an abscess.
That makes me feel a bit better than it being a cancer.
Yeah.
Thank you. It is a big relief to know it's not cancer and that it's just an abscess, but it's still a little scary.
What's happened here is we've had an initial infection, which has caused a sudden massive pus to form there.
Okay.
What happens with reptiles is that they can't break that pus down themselves. They're left with a lump.
Okay.
And it becomes firmer, harder, and it just stays there. The problem with this abscess is that essentially it's a ball of bacteria. If we don't do anything about it, it can very easily spread around the rest of the body, and from there, it could kill her. So she's gonna need to stay with us, and we're gonna need to actually put her under anesthetic.
Okay.
And actually cut that lump out.
Do you hear that, Harriet?
The one thing that we just need to be mindful of is that reptile anesthetics are tricky.
Yeah.
They're hard. They don't generally breathe that well for themselves or under anaesthetic.
Oh, okay.
So it becomes quite a big procedure to get her under anaesthetic and keep her there.
Yep.
Even though Harriet's small and we're dealing with something like an abscess, there's still a lot that can go wrong. All right. need to say goodbye?
I'm just worried that Harriet won't pull through it, but it's always that worry, isn't there? We've just got to deal with it. See you, sweetie.
Come on, Harriet, it's time. You ready, mate?
Tell you right.
Chris and Andrew are about to start surgery to remove an abscess from Harriet's leg.
Let's get that beautiful bead of yours in here. Come on, it's okay.
But putting the three-year-old under anaesthetic is incredibly dangerous.
The underlying problem with any reptile is their whole metabolism works incredibly slowly. So they can be holding their breath and be fine, or they can not be breathing and be far from fine. And they both look the same. Tails has dropped there. Now we're pretty close there, if you'll let you go.
Yeah, all ready to go.
Andrew is assisting Chris with the delicate operation, keeping a constant watch on Harriet's vital signs.
They are darn difficult things to monitor the anaesthetic of.
I'm pretty happy how deep she is. We'll just get her back on in two. Harriet, being a reptile, is living up to the hype. She's breathing incredibly shallow, but her heart rate at the moment is pretty stable, so that's good enough. It's time to get started. Just cut over the abscess there. And now we just need to get in and around it and essentially shell it out. So the trick now is gonna be getting right around what is gonna be a pretty decent sized mass. Beautiful.
Beautiful job.
So I'm just going to flush this hole here and just to remove any bacteria that might still be sitting inside there. It's time to sew it back up. Two stitches to go. Sure good.
I'm not getting a reading on her heart rate.
Suddenly, Andrew notices a change in Harriet.
She's just not breathing well. She's just breath holding and...
Yep.
Any more reflexes?
Not really. Come on, Harriet, come on. We've been through so much. Don't give up now. Just a little bit.
That's what I like to see.
At last, the three-year-old gives Chris and Andrew the sign they've been waiting for.
It's hard to believe that something as minor as a tongue flick can mean so much, but with Harriet, it means she's coming back.
Well done, Chris.
I've got to say, it's good to see you. You went quiet on us.
An antibiotic injection completes Harriet's treatment.
You settle down. Look, see all these signs of life now? Would have been quite handy when you're actually under anaesthetic. Yeah? Should we put you away in the cage? Then you've earned a rest. Another one. Go on. Let's go. It's pretty amazing to think that this clinic sees all the big stuff, but it's been a tiny little bearded dragon today that's caused us to have a wild ride. But she's pulled through. You rest up, okay? No more beard talk. Can you hear me okay? Yeah, I should know better than to keep a lady waiting, shouldn't I?
Harriet, the bearded dragon, has recovered from surgery to remove an abscess from her leg and is ready to head back to the Kyabram Fauna Park.
Helen's going to be happy to see you. You go home. Now, mate, me and the bearded lady are heading out, and then I'm going to head home.
Righty, well, it's been darn good to have you. You've done a really good job.
Absolute pleasure.
I'll tell you what, if things don't go so well up at Bondi for him, I reckon we could fit him into the practice down here all right. He seems to do a pretty good job.
Now, Someone's been missing you.
Harriet.
A little girl in here.
Yeah? Oh. We're happy to have you back, Harriet. Chris has done a great job. She looks really good and healthy, so everything looks like it's worked out well, and so we're very happy with that.
Is this a good spot here? She
likes
it?
She'll be fine there. She'll like that. Good girl.
She's gonna pose first. There you go.
You're home.
Neither Hannah nor Harriet will probably ever truly understand just how tense that surgery really was, but I do. That's why I'm very happy to see her home.
She's settled back in well.
All right, well, I'm done.
Just before you go, Chris, there is another job for you. We have a baby koala and he needs a checkup.
Okay. I can delay my trip just a little bit for
Thank
a baby koala, surely.
Thanks, that'd be great.
All right. After all the action, the excitement, and sometimes the stress of this week, finishing with a cute and cuddly koala probably isn't a bad thing.
It's just up here. She'll be up here with Mum. Yep, so little
buddy
just up there with Mum.
Hey, little buddy.
Little Kay is just 8 months old and needs to be weighed to make sure he's growing normally.
Just looking for a temporary loan. It's okay, little man. Okay. Hey, no, you're right. It's okay. Come with me. I'm gonna give you a perch here. There we go. There we go. Here we go. You happy? That's cheating.
He's weighing.
You're trying to take some weight off there. Well, it's worked.
Cool.
About 1.5 kilos.
Thank you very much for that. You're a feisty little boy.
You want to go back to Mum, do you? Oh, you really, you're chucking a tantrum, aren't you? You want to go back to Mum? When you look at how feisty and full of energy Kay is, and you add that to a healthy weight, you know he's doing well.
1.5 kilos, if you were wondering.
Looks like he's happy to be back with Mum.
Yeah, he sure is.
Well, I'm done. I'm back to Bondi.
Thank you very much for that. It's nice to meet you.
It was a nice way to finish up. Thank you.
No worries.
It's been a tough week. It's been a great week. They've made me feel so incredibly welcome. But now, I'm heading back to Bondi.
It's coming down.
Yeah, just got a phone call. This guy is a pet goanna that's been attacked by one of his bigger ones. So the one that attacked him was probably about that big. And the one that's coming down, the one that's coming down is probably only about a kilo.
It's pretty bad. It's a couple of centimetres deep and all across from one side to the other.
Peter has a collection of 20 goannas at home, and one of the larger family members has attacked the much smaller 5-year-old Belly.
To be honest, I am a little bit scared of reptiles. They give me the creeps. And treating or handling one of these is a bit of a nightmare for me.
Hi, little one.
You can't really trust him. I've been bitten by her actually a while back when she was smaller. I had to go to hospital for that.
I'm gonna actually, if you don't mind, take her out the back and get Jess, our nurse, to help me get that bandage off and we can take a look.
We're supposed to learn about all animals at uni, but quite honestly, all I can remember about lizards and reptiles are a few lectures we had back in third year.
Yeah, if you can be comfortable that you're gonna hold her and that she's not gonna bite me, because honestly, I don't deal with reptiles very often and I'm instilling all my faith in you.
Okay. I used to work up at Australia Zoo Wildlife Hospital, and we did a lot of lace monitors up there, wild ones, so I don't have a problem with a pet one. They're really cute as babies. Very, very cute. So they're just misunderstood. It's the claws and the tails that you need to watch out for in these guys, not necessarily their mouth.
All right. Now, her tail, is there a spike?
No, they flick it really, really hard.
They just flick it hard. Yeah. Okay, so I'm just going to get, like, bruised from that and scratched and shredded from the claws. Fantastic. I'm a bit nervous. I'm looking at his claws.
Belly the lace monitor has been savaged by one of the huge goannas she lives with.
I don't even like the feel of this.
But before Lisa can treat the severe wound, she wants to give Belly a general anaesthetic. Finding the right spot is proving extremely difficult.
Oh my God, Steph! It's not the easiest thing to do because you can't really see the vein. I guess if I was taking blood for a dog or a cat, I could feel the vein and I could see it. Here we're kind of going in blind.
There it is.
Yay! Oh, How good is that?
And they're just helping out.
Woohoo! I anesthetized a lace monitor. But maybe the first and last time.
Right, hon, just take some deep breaths. Talking to a lizard here. Look, oh, she's really been ripped to pieces here. I see all the flesh and muscle right underneath there, so that big lace monitor has obviously come up to her and just taken a chunk out of her neck, and this needs to be stitched. I guess the main thing that I'm concerned about is infection. Goannas have got really nasty bacteria in their mouth and in their claws, and that bacteria can almost be venomous, it's that bad. So if we don't stitch up this wound and get her on some antibiotics, she can die from septic infection. How far down are we going? We've got to work pretty quickly here because they're obviously very sensitive animals, very prone to stress.
Belly, the lace monitor, has had her neck ripped open by a much larger goanna.
The muscle under there is really shredded. The good thing is it doesn't look like it's gone through to her spinal cord. If it had, she would probably be paralysed, but I really need to fix up this shredded muscle and treat any chance of infection. Even though these reptiles freak me out a little bit, looking at Belly, I actually feel quite sorry for her. She has been bullied by a big bloke and she has copped a terrible bite. Thank you. All right, here we go. Her skin is really thick and tough, so I need to use a very thick suture material in order to close that wound. In a dog or cat, I would use something a lot finer. I'm trying to do neat ones so that she still maintains her attractive looks. And we're done.
Anti-inflammatory and antibiotic injections finish the lace monitor's treatment.
So just before she wakes up, did you want to give her a bit of a kiss on the nose?
I can't. I can't do it.
You don't. No?
Come on, kiss goodbye. It's important for me to see her moving like this. It emphasises the fact that there's no damage to her spinal cord and she's recovered well from the procedure. I think now we'll pop her back to bed to wake up more. I'm feeling pretty chuffed with myself now. I think that all went very well. If another one came in, yes, I would treat it.
While Lisa is congratulating herself on controlling her fear of reptiles, vet nurse Jess is still not convinced.
Oh my God! You are evil, all of you.
She's still a princess until she kisses a toad.
You should be telling me how brave I was. I was so brave. Okay, all done. She was very well behaved.
Belly's going home after surviving an attack that nearly tore her neck apart.
Bye-bye. Who knows, maybe I'll become Sasha's resident lace monitor specialist. There's my role. But I'll never kiss one. That is never, ever, ever going to happen.
Yeah, Billy. So Belly's in this one?
Yeah, Billy's in here.
A few days later, vet nurse Jess visits Peter's reptile resort to check up on Belly's progress.
It's a bit of a size difference here.
The patient is being reacquainted with Big Rex, who nearly tore the lace monitor's head off.
Mm. He's having a bit of a taste there.
Yeah.
Don't want any fighting going on here.
They're cold?
Yeah. Oh, he's not very happy, is he? She's incredibly lucky. I think she should buy the next lotto ticket, maybe.
They're cornered, then they will try and strike out with their claws, or they can even inflict a bit of a bite. Here we go. Quite a bit of saliva floating around. I don't know if this is a joke or not, but I've just had a call to a family that has been bailed up in their house by a lizard. I don't know how big the lizard it is, what sort of lizard it is, even if it is a lizard, it could be a snake. We've got to get there, help out the family, and try and end this standoff. Glenn, is it?
Glenn, yeah.
All right, I'm Chris, this is Barry.
Oh, nice to meet you.
You too. What have we got here?
We were a bit worried, we didn't know what it was. We didn't want to get bitten or anything like that, so we thought we'd better bring the professionals and get them to come out and have a look at it.
As Chris and wildlife expert Barry try to corral the home intruder, they're relieved to find out they're hunting a water dragon and not a snake.
Water dragons generally aren't dangerous, except when they're threatened. They're cornered, then they will try and strike out with their claws, or they can even inflict a bit of a bite. In that case, I'll be turning the camera off straight away, obviously mopping up the blood and pretending that never happened.
You're hot, Barry. It's hot in here,
isn't it?
It's
warm, isn't it?
Just think of a nice, cool, calm little stream, pond, calm, relaxing music. Ignore the big hand that's about to come in.
Here we go.
Probably the only concern is the fact that he's pretty placid. He didn't put up much of a fight there, which, you know, in the short term is a good thing, but long term you want him to be actually pretty feisty, because that usually implies that he's healthy. I want to thank your landlords for the hospitality. You say goodbye?
Bye.
Bye.
It's a built-up environment. We've got dogs, we've got people, we've got cars. That's not safe for him to be around. We'll take him back to the clinic and give him a good once-over and really make sure he's ready to be released. And if he is, then I've got the perfect spot in mind. See you later.
See you later. No worries.
All right, so it's a brown snake.
Oh, OK.
Yeah.
Stick your hand in, go for it.
At the Bondi Clinic, Chris is attempting to scare vet nurse Liesl.
Ah!
But she's just not biting.
No, I'm glad. Really.
Cute animal, no lie.
Yeah, of course. You're beautiful.
It does have little teeth. Massive tongue. Good at that?
Don't know if you're his type.
Do you reckon just play it slow first of all?
I think so. Maybe dinner first.
I'm looking for a few things here, most importantly the gum colour. I want to make sure that he's nice and pink. That just tells me that his circulation's working well and that he's got enough nutrients. You can tell a lot about his level of hydration too. If he's lacking in saliva or if his saliva's very dry and tacky, then he's going to be really dehydrated. Whereas here he's got quite a bit of saliva floating around. That really hurts. Really hurts. That's all right. It was the tongue thing, wasn't it? It was the kiss. His teeth are fine. They're working really well, actually. Really well. So that reassures me that everything's going to be okay. That really hurts. Probably sticking your finger inside a water dragon's mouth isn't the best idea. Maybe if you come across one at home, don't do that. I know you can hear the water, but that's not your kind of water. It's salty.
The water dragon's been given a clean bill of health, and Chris is now very happy to release him.
Don't mind it, huh? Can you hear the other guys?
The snappy lizard's new address is prime leafy real estate close to the harbour.
Our time together must come to an end. This will be perfect for him. It's really his all-you-can-eat buffet. And we know he can eat. He eats very well. Shake hands and apologise? No. Seems pretty content.
Now, I've been driving up here wondering, how does a lizard break its leg?
He gets in a fight with his wife.
Okay, that true. Explains it.
She bit him, rolled and tumbled, and his leg's toast.
All right, let's go and see this.
Yeah, I'll show you where he is.
Now.
Follow me. I've called Chris up to have a look at a little Centralian blue tongue. Larry's had a bit of an altercation with his girlfriend. The leg's limp. It's straight out. He hasn't used it for a few days now. Doesn't look good.
He's obviously not happy.
Doesn't want to move it, does he?
No, he doesn't. That's a good example as he's turning. That should be the time it's really digging in, pushing off, but he's just got it stretched out.
Yeah. Looks sore.
Without an x-ray, it's often tricky to know whether you're dealing with a fractured leg or a dislocation or a serious sprain or even a bruise. But in this case, looking at the way the leg has deviated and is essentially deformed now, you know it's broken. I feel like we need to be doing something to that to try to fix it.
Yeah.
Because if we don't, it's just gonna keep on dragging along behind it.
Yeah.
But the tricky thing is you can't put a blue-tongued lizard on crutches.
No. The worry is if he's got a broken leg and the bones are in there grinding on each other, that he's in a lot of pain. So I guess even if Chris can't make his leg perfect, he can stop him from being in pain.
You just need to work out exactly where this break is. We can do it fairly easily by just comparing the good leg with the bad leg. I think this area here, which is his femur, is fine, because when you compare it to this side, they're very similar.
Yeah.
I think his hip joint's intact because he can do all the movements that this leg can do.
Yeah.
They can really lift it up and lift it down.
Yeah.
But where he struggles is in the stuff below what is his knee. And he just really doesn't want to bend that leg at all.
And that would make sense. If the female was to bite him, she's going to get the end of the leg, not up near the hip.
Yeah, exactly. Once I get to the tibia, which is the long leg bone, I can see there's a big deviation. It's really sunken in and twisted. So we know where the fracture is. What we don't know, though, is how we're going to fix it. It's about as small as bones get.
What are you going to do?
Well, I don't know. Even though it's a very small fracture, it'll cause big problems if we can't fix it. So now I have to come up with some way to fix a broken leg in a lizard. That won't be easy. We really need to get that bend back into it. We need to get some strength into it. But we need to keep the bones still enough that they actually do mend up.
And that'll ease his pain a bit as well if it's there?
Yeah. I'm racking my brain for ideas about how we fix this leg. Pins aren't going to work, wires aren't going to work, screws, impossible. All of a sudden, it comes to me. You feel like helping me out?
Oh, I'd love to help you out.
Yeah?
Yeah, what can I do?
But you've been working hard.
I've been working hard.
Okay. Why don't you go and have an ice cream?
Yep.
And come back once you finish the ice cream.
Okay, I can do that. See you in a minute.
Got to realise there's an ulterior motive here. I need something from this ice cream. First of all, I need Tim to finish it.
Wasn't a very nice one.
Clean your mouth. Look at you.
I've still got some there.
Yeah. Good old Tim seemingly approaches ice creams like he approaches everything else in life. 100 miles an hour. There is chocolate all over his face. But Tim has left me the most important part of the ice cream, which is the stick. This stick, once it's cut down, will be a perfect splint for this lizard's broken leg.
You sure an ideas, man. You know, this is the good thing about Chris. I'm there thinking about a possible amputation, and he's got a simple solution that's going to work. Best case for the lizard.
All right, Timmy, so I'm going to need your help here. So the idea is going to be put this splint over the top, and where there's that bow in the leg, a tape should actually bring that and straighten that out. Everything here is painstakingly small and painstakingly delicate. But if you get it wrong, the consequences will be dramatic. Larry will just not tolerate a splint that doesn't fit and that rubs on his leg. So just getting it right is crucial.
I'm pretty happy with how that's sitting there. Let's give it a test drive.
Okay, you want him down?
Yeah. Yeah, already supporting more weight on that.
That must feel really good for him.
Instantly, literally instantly, he's up on his leg. What a solution.
So if you can leave this splint on for ideally 3 weeks,
yep.
I think we'll be laughing.
The good news is that Larry should make a full recovery, but there are no guarantees about his love life.
Larry has a lot of L's in his life. Lonely, loveless, unlucky in love. The one L he won't be having for quite a few weeks though is a lady. They're definitely off limits.